Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We had a great day last Sunday with the baptisms, and we're going to show you a video of that a little later. You'll see us flinching with the cold and just enjoying that special occasion as we had six baptisms in the sea. In the Bible, in John chapter 4, Jesus said to the woman at the well, "A time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks." God is spirit. Notice that. God is spirit. He doesn't have a material body. He stands outside of creation. He is the creator of everything that exists. God is spirit. And his worshippers must worship in spirit and in truth. Let's just come to God in prayer. Almighty God, our loving Heavenly Father, as we gather in this place to give you our worship and our praise today, we pray that the Holy Spirit might inspire us in our worship so that we might glorify you and give you all honor and praise for who you are and for what you do. And we pray, Father, that you will come among us by your Spirit and bring your truth into our hearts and into our minds to shape our lives and help us to be the kind of worshippers who worship you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, every day of the year. Lord, let us be the worshippers that you are seeking. Bless us then. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship God together and sing how creation sings the Father's song. We'll stand to sing.
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to wake the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson rays. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon his very gold. He charts the eagle's flight, commands the newborn baby's cry. Stand and sing, hallelujah. Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's name. Creation gazed upon his face. The age was swelled in times of grace. Unveiled the Father's plan of reconciling God. Would break the curse, whose death has set us free to live with him eternally. Hallelujah! Let all creation stand and sing. Hallelujah! Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's name. Creation longs for his return, when Christ shall reign upon the earth. The bitter wars that rage are both things of a coming age. When he renews the land and sky, all men will sing and earth reply. With one resplendent theme, the glory of our God and King. Let all creation stand and sing. Hallelujah! Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's name. Hallelujah! Let all
I'm Jackie, Deacon of the Community Ministry team. We held a meeting in June to discuss some initiatives to help us to connect back to our existing Lunch Club members and for those to reunite again with one another. So we came up with an idea with a tea, coffee, cake get together. Every Monday at Griffin Park Hall from 2:30 to 3:30, price £2 or donation. Then we sent out invitations and asked if they could respond, as we are limited to 30 sitting places. Checked out our safety regulations and did our first one on Monday, 5th of July. Now we've done four and extremely going well. And it's wonderful to see them reuniting in a safe environment. We've had a rota of amazing cake makers, a wonderful dedicated team of volunteers. It's really is such a pleasure for us to be able to engage with our community. If there's anyone who know who could benefit from coming along, someone lonely, someone frightened to go out to socialize, do feel free to just get in touch. It's been very difficult over the last 18 months. So now let's enjoy each other's company with safety guidelines in place. Let us pray. Oh, but God, we know you can redeem what's broken. You can care about community and you created us for a connection. And you also gave us your Holy Spirit who understands that we are facing and prays on our behalf. So when we feel alone, please remind us that you are near and that you're not done working. Re-establish our relationships and show us how to make meaningful connections, even if it feels uncomfortable at first. Ultimately, we want our loneliness to lead us closer to you and to the people that you have called us to love and support. So take our isolation and our disconnection, our social anxiety and our fears, and turn it into something beautiful that draws the world closer to you and to each other. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I'm going to want you to enjoy a short video and just have a look at those cakes. It's a good job our Pastor Martin is on his sabbatical. Thank you. Bye for now. God bless. So here we go. Keep waving. Oh, that's better. Here's the beautiful cakes that are going to be distributed.
If you have a Bible, please turn with me to Acts chapter 17 and verses 16 to 36. Acts chapter 17, verses 16 to 34, sorry. While Paul was waiting for his friends in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting. You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean. All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Now, what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, and others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. At that, Paul left the council. A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, and a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. May God bless to us the reading of his word. Do you believe in God? Yes? No? Not sure? Lovely to have quite a few of you shout yes, but that raises the question, which one? You see, there are hundreds of different gods worshipped in the world today. There have been thousands of different gods worshipped in the world over human history, and they are not all the same. The nature and the character of these gods is different. They are mutually exclusive. And so I want to ask you which God you believe in, if you believe in God. The Bible teaches us that there are many false gods, but only one true God. The God of the Bible is the God of holiness and of love and of compassion and of kindness. And over the next few weeks, we're going to look at the nature and the character of the God of the Bible so that we might understand better the nature and character of the God that we believe in. And this is important, because our beliefs in God shape our behavior. If our God is nasty or harsh, then we will become nasty or harsh. If our God is soft and almost unreal, our religion will be soft and unreal. So the God that we believe in is important. What is he like? Because the God you believe in shapes the person that you become. Now, our present Western culture is dismissive of God. And there are various responses to the existence of God in the world around us today. There are atheists who say, there is no God. That you're foolish to believe in God. There are agnostics who say, I don't know if there's a God or not. And some of them are almost dishonest agnostics. They don't want to know. Because if there is a God, it shapes the way you live. So some people just don't want to know, don't want to ask the question, don't want to find the answer. And then there are adherents of God, of all different kinds of God, all different religion. But remember that the many gods are contradictory. So in coming weeks, I want us to think about the Christian God, about the God of the Bible. I want us to look at his nature and his character and how that will shape us to become the kind of people that God wants us to be. And I want to start this message, this series, with this message, our God is real. Okay, I'm going to try to keep things simple. It is not going to be easy. Because when we talk about the existence of God, I'm going to share with you some very deep things, but in a very simple way. So you've been forewarned, okay? And if as you listen to that, this message this morning, you think, well, that's a bit simple. What about this? What about that? I don't mind you asking questions. You can get back to me. You can talk to me personally. Or if you're watching online, you can email us with your questions. Because I hope that I will raise a few questions as we think about who our God is. What is he like? How do we know he's there? And right at the start of the series, I want to begin with this. Our God is real. In other weeks, I'll talk about how our God is love. Our God is true. Our God is caring. Our God is loving. And much more about the nature and character of God. But we need to start here. Because if God is not real, then all the rest is make-believe. Our God is real. Let me start with the Bible. In Acts 17, the Apostle Paul comes to the capital of Greece, Athens, and he tries to tell the people there about our God, the God of the Bible, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we know quite a bit about what Athens looked like at the time. There was the mountain with the Parthenon on top, if anybody's been to Athens. Down below there was the marketplace, the agora. And around that, you know, civic buildings, and there was a Jewish synagogue. And at first it was in the marketplace and in the synagogue that Paul was preaching and teaching about Jesus. But then he gets invited to what was basically the university, Mars Hill, this hill here, just below the Parthenon. And on Mars Hill, the philosophers would meet to discuss and debate the latest ideas about life, about God, and about everything. You with me? Pictures helpful? So that we can just begin to understand that it was there in the shadow of the Parthenon with all of the different temples to the Greek gods that Paul begins to explain about the one true God who reveals himself in Jesus Christ. The main temple on the Parthenon was to Athena, and Athens is named after Athena. She was the god of love and sex and birth and all of those things. Athena. The Greeks, though, had 12 major gods and many minor ones, and the chief one was Zeus, And his temple was in Olympia. If any of you have been to Greece, they could take you to where the temple of Zeus was in Olympia, where they had a huge statue of this man with a big old white beard seated on a throne. If your image of God is of an old man in a white beard on a throne, then your image is of Zeus and not of the God of the Bible. Because the God of the Bible doesn't have a body. He is spirit, and to be worshipped in spirit and in truth. So we do not make images of God. Second commandment. Do you get it? We need to make sure that we don't have a false picture of God, because it will lead to false behavior. So as Paul is there in Athens with all of these gods, the 12 major ones and the hundreds of minor ones, he notices how superstitious the people are. And he says, I see that in every way you're very much religious. And by religious, Paul means superstitious, okay? You know, cross your fingers and hope for the best, or sacrifice to the gods. For as I looked around and carefully looked at your objects of worship, and probably went up on the Parthenon and looked at the temples, I even found an altar with this inscription to an unknown god. They were so superstitious, they believed in so many gods, they didn't want to miss one out. Just in case. And actually, archaeologists have found an altar to an unknown god. Not in Athens, actually, but in Rome, in Italy. And it's just a stone altar with a space on top where they would light a fire and they would burn incense as a prayer and an offering to the unknown God because of their superstition. So I want to unearth this, okay? Because our culture and society today is just like it was in ancient Rome and in ancient Greece. There are many gods. There are many superstitious people around. There are atheists, agnostics, and adherents of many different gods, but there is still the need to explain to people that in fact there's only one true God, the God of the Bible, the God who reveals himself at the most complete and fullest in the life of Jesus Christ. Okay? So, Paul wants to tell them about the real God. He says, what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you. Acts 17, verse 23. The God they are half aware of, the God they have not fully grasped. And it may be that there's somebody here today, you're half aware of God. You've not fully grasped what God is like. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at what God is really like. And I want to start with this, that our God is not something that we've made up. It's not human imagination. Our God is real. Very briefly and simply, five things that point to the reality of God and that it is the one true God of the Bible. Number one, science. At one time, scientists thought the universe was without beginning or without end. It was called the steady state theory. 100 years ago, if you did science, physics, or biology in university, you would have been taught the steady state theory of the universe, of the cosmos. In the last 100 years, scientists have decided that the universe actually has a beginning, a dramatic beginning. They call it a Big Bang. And that is amazing that science has come around to what the Bible was saying 3,500 years ago, when it said, in the beginning, there was a beginning. And that beginning was because God created the heavens and the earth. Science is only back engineering the work of God. We can get back now scientifically, they think, to that moment of the Big Bang, but why is there anything? Why is there life? God is the uncreated cause of everything that has been created. There is a mind behind creation. This is what the Bible is telling us. If I took my computer home and took it apart, I could explain scientifically all the parts of it, but not why it works. My computer works because with all that parts, it's got a computer program inside it. You with me? And that computer program tells us that originally there was a creator, a programmer, a designer. And as physics and science looks at the world around us and it sees physical laws and design in nature, there is a programmer, there is a creator, there is a designer behind all that we now see. Scientists talk about an anthropic principle. It is as if the world, the universe, is designed for life. Why? Because there is a designer who wanted there to be life. So in Psalm 19, 1,000 years ago, King David and others could sing that the heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. There is a mind and a purpose and a meaning to life and the universe. Maybe it surprises you that I want to start with science. Science is not the enemy of faith. Science, understood properly, supports faith. Atheism, on the other hand, takes more faith than Christianity. Because with atheism, everything has come from nothing with no purpose. Someone has summed it up like this. Atheism, the belief that there was nothing. Nothing happened to nothing, and then nothing magically exploded for no reason, creating everything. And then a bunch of everything magically rearranged itself for no reason whatsoever into self-replicating bits which then turned into dinosaurs. Makes perfect sense, doesn't it? The complexity of the universe, and yet it operating to ordered scientific laws, is a pointer to a mind behind all that exists. I can go into this deeper on another occasion. I'm going to try and keep it simple, okay? So if it sounds simplistic, it's because I'm trying to keep it simple, okay? If you want to know more, have a word with me later, email me, talk with me, and we can go into some of this a whole lot more deeply. The second thing is nature. Nature points to the existence of God. Life flows according to the laws of nature. And if there are laws to nature, there is a lawgiver. Romans chapter 1 verse 20 says, since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without an excuse. There is a mind, a program to nature, and a programmer to the program. Francis Collins was the lead scientist behind the Human Genome Project that cracked the DNA code. A former atheist, now a convinced Christian, he's written an excellent book, A Scientist presents Evidence for Belief, The Language of God. First one who wants to borrow it and asks for it can have it, okay? But I do want it back. He is a top scientist, a biologist, involved with cracking the DNA code, and they called it The Language of God. His book is an excellent book. DNA is the building blocks of life on nature. He explains there that actually biology is made up of two words. It's Greek. Bios, life, and logos, word. That logos is a very important word for Christians. In John chapter 1, where it says, the Word became flesh, the Logos became flesh. The reason, the Word, the express thought, the Logos, the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. He talks of biologos, of God being in and through life in every way. The complexity of life is appointed to God. Yet in that complexity, there's not chaos, but order that points to a higher power at work. I'm keeping it simple. If you want to read more, come and see me later. So we've got science pointing towards God, nature pointing towards God, scripture pointing towards God, the Bible, the history of God's people, Israel, and the church, and their supernatural survival. Prophecies of the Messiah. I challenge anybody to read Isaiah 53, written 700 years before Jesus was born, and not see there that it's talking about Jesus Christ and His resurrection, preparing people for what was to come. The testimony of the disciples in the Gospels and in the epistles and in the book of Acts, showing Jesus Christ. So the writer to the Hebrews says, in the past, God spoke, God revealed Himself, God showed that He's real to our forefathers through the prophets many times and in various ways, but in these last days He has spoken to us in His Son. You want proof of God? The proof of God is the life of Jesus. Jesus is the fullest, greatest, most complete revelation of God that you will ever know or find. So when the disciples once said to Jesus, show us the Father, Jesus replied, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. You want to know what God is like? You will find Him in Jesus. Fascinating thing. There is no physical description of Jesus in the Bible or anywhere. Because when we think of God, we must not think of Him as having a human body. God is spirit, remember? Those that worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. So when Jesus says, anyone who's seen me has seen the Father, it doesn't mean that when we see God the Father, He'll have arms and legs like a human being. What He's talking about is anyone who's seen me, who's known my character, who's known my personality, who's seen my love, who's seen my holiness, who's seen my generosity, who's seen the way that I live truth. All of those things about nature and personality. You want to know God, you'll see Him in Jesus. Make sense? Okay? So read your Bibles. If the best place to know God in simple terms is in scripture and in the life of Jesus, and to experience that. I'll tell you more about this in coming weeks. Number four of five, experience. People can say, I believe in God, not because anyone told me, but because I have experienced His goodness and mercy in my life. This is why testimonies are so important. You tell people what God has done for you, and God becomes more real to them. In the Old Testament, there's the story of Naaman the leper. And Naaman was a Syrian, and he prayed to Assyrian gods and had not been healed of his leprosy. And then he'd learned about the prophet in Israel. And he'd gone to Israel and saw, was it Elisha or Elijah? It is one or the other. And he's told, go and baptize yourself, immerse yourself 7 times in the River Jordan. And as he does, he comes out cleansed, healed by the power of the one true living God. And his response to this is that he says, now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. I know it because I've experienced it. And maybe that I hope there are many people in this room today who say, I know there's a God, And I might not be able to explain to you all the science and the theology and the nature and all of those things that Martin has been on about, but I know there's a God because I've experienced him in my life. I've seen his answers to my prayers. He's brought hope, he's brought healing, he's brought help. I have experienced God. And this experience of God in our life, it's not just for us. We need to share that testimony with others, because it will point them to God as well. Even today, this is Steve. Steve was taken into care when he was 12 years old. He ended up getting into all sorts of trouble. Drugs, crime, prison, brokenness of mental health. Went to rehab, found Jesus, put his trust in Jesus. He says, Jesus Christ has turned my life around. He has experienced God. You ask him how he knows there's a God? He says, because of what God has done for me. Now he's working with the message, with one of their Eden teams in the north of England, taking the love of Jesus to others who need to know that God is real. And meeting that real God can change your life. Beliefs shape our behavior. And then fifth and lastly, sentience. I'm going to get a little bit deep again for a moment. Sentience is the ability to think and to feel, our consciousness that behind our face is a mind. Genesis chapter 1 says God created humanity, man, in his own image. That doesn't mean that God has arms and legs like you and me, okay? What it means is that we can think, and we can feel, and we can love, and we can hate, or we can create, and we can destroy. We can choose. That's what it means to be in the image of God. Descartes has these famous words. Cogito ergo sum. You heard this before? I think, cogito ergo, therefore sum I am. We know that we are living beings because we have a mind inside our body. So when I get up in the morning and I go and have a wash and I look in the mirror, I see my face. But I am much more than my face. If a scientist or a biologist were to take my body apart, he'd be able to explain every part of my body, the chemicals and even the electric currents that go back and forth across my mind. But deeper than that, behind all of those things, there's me. Yep. Behind the material is the spiritual person, is the me behind my body. When you look in a mirror, you see an image of God, not in your face, but in the mind that is looking upon that face. Behind all the material of the universe, there is a mind that thinks, that creates, that loves. And it is this aspect of human consciousness which is turning many philosophers at present to God. When I did philosophy as part of my degree 40 years ago, one of the top atheists was a man called Anthony Flew. And we were made to study Anthony Flew's arguments against the existence of God. If you want to be a minister, you've got to know these things. It shocked everyone when around about 2005, Anthony Flew changed his mind. He says, you've got to follow the facts. You've got to go on the basis of reason. And now, the world's notorious atheist changed his mind and says there's a God. And one of the reasons was because of the existence of consciousness. There is consciousness behind nature. If anybody wants to borrow the book, first one to ask me can have it and have a read. Okay? I'm trying to keep it simple, so forgive me for skipping on very quickly. But we are proof of God in and ourselves. We are in the image of God. We have a mind beyond and behind our face. If you have questions about these things, then you're welcome to ask. There will be opportunity perhaps at your home groups through the week. And maybe this is a good opportunity as well for me to say, we're going to start a home group for new Christians, where you're won't maybe go as deep as in some of the other home groups, where you can ask the questions that you might be embarrassed to ask anywhere else about God and about faith. And if you'd like to join a group, a home group for new Christians, it'd probably be during the daytime, then would you have a word with myself, Liz, Megan, where's Megan? Megan, you this morning? Yeah, she's at the back waving, or Irwin. Okay, so we're going to set up a home group for new Christians where you can ask questions as well, particularly those which are much simpler. Okay, so when Paul was in Athens, he says that God has given us clues about his existence so that men would seek him and find him. We can know this God. You ever played hide and seek? Did you like hide and seek?
Yeah.
You ever played hide and seek when one is a child and one is an adult? One has a more mature mind and one is immature? Maybe you were the child and you played with your parents, or maybe you were the parent and you played with your child. Now if the mature mind, the parent, doesn't want to be found, the child's not going to find them, are they? You know, maybe if you just wanted a break from your kids when they were growing up. Let's play hide and seek. But if you didn't want to be found, you wouldn't be. But normally when you played hide and seek with a child, you wanted to be found, because there's that joy of the finding and the relationship. God wants to be found, and he invites us to seek him. So when a parent plays hide and seek, if you're hiding behind the door, you stick your foot out, don't you? So that they can see it. Or if you're hiding behind the curtains, you make sure that the curtains are bulging. And if the little one is toddling by and missing even those signs, you give a little cough or something so that they know, because it's the joy of the finding. You with me? You following this? God wants us to seek and to find him. So in the Bible, we find verses like this. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Mom, where are you? Dad, which cupboard are you hiding in? Call on him while he is near, and let the wicked forsake his way and the evil man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, to our God, for he will freely pardon. Seek God, you can find him. Maybe start with a prayer like this one, calling out to God for forgiveness and inviting him into your life. If you want to study more about the character of God, this is a good old book from the 20th century, J.I. Packer, Knowing God, and particularly the second and third parts of the book, which talks about the nature and character of God, recommended to you. But putting all this together, so what? Listen, the world today is no different to what it was in Athens. There are atheists, agnostics, and adherents of many different religions. The Bible tells us there is only one true God. This is the God we need to know. We are pointed to him through science and nature and scripture and experience and sentience and much more. So let me ask you again that question. Do you believe in God? If so, which one? Do you believe in this real God? Our God is real. You can know him. And in knowing him, he will make a tremendous difference in your life. You can know him personally. You can experience him. It'll shape your prayers. It will shape your words and actions. This real God. I'll tell you much more about what he's like in coming weeks. Let's just pause for a moment to pray. If you've not yet sought and found this living God, then ask him to come into your life and make himself known to you today. If you have family or friends who are atheists, or agnostics, or adherents of other religions. Send up a silent prayer for them now, that they will come to know and experience the true and living God in their lives. Amen. Okay, let's sing about our amazing God, and then we're going to see the videos from the baptisms last Sunday. Sees all our faults and failures and loves us the same. One of the things we'll be thinking about in coming weeks is our God is love. So isn't that tremendous? So we had a tremendous time last Sunday, and we had six people baptized. Five of them are here this morning. I think five. Is Anne here? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we've got a video of the baptisms and the baptism certificate. So I'll give those out and I'm going to give them a little clap of encouragement.
Susan, do you trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? today to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in the church, world, for the rest of your life.
Yes.
Susan, on your confession of faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, do you trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior?
Yes, I
do. You promise, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in the church for the rest of your life.
Yes, I do.
Now, on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Shirley, do you trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord?
Yes, I do.
Do you promise, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in the church and the world for the rest of your life?
Yes, I do.
Shirley, on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I think it's amazing. I think it's just brilliant.
Okay, you're all right.
We're all right. You're in safe hands.
Well, let's pay me to hold you up the longer. Hands together like you're praying. Feet together and just keep them straight. Now, do you trust in Jesus Christ? You promise, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in the church and the world for the rest of your life. On your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I'll turn around and see if you can hands together. Okay, and lift your fingers and feet together and just keep your legs straight. Joel, do you trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord? Do you promise, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in the church and the world for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Joe, on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? Andrew? Trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord.
I do.
Do you promise, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in the church and the world for the rest of your life?
I do.
Andrew, on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Is there anyone else?
last Sunday with the baptisms. And could you see us flinching with the water? Well, the shock of Steve and I on our faces when one of our members who came in to film was knocked over by a wave. We won't mention who. And Hazel, what were you thinking when Andrew?
I don't know. I didn't know why he was going
out. Andrew's going to give his testimony in a week or so's time of why God moved him on that occasion to come forward for baptism, and that would be lovely. And we'll give him a video and a certificate as well. So before the service this morning, Karen was saying that God was just laying on her heart to say to those who baptized, sometimes the devil has a little go at your faith after your baptism. God was saying to her, just wanting you to know, to get ready, you will have a little battle sometime soon. Okay, so be prepared for that. It's normal. Okay, it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with you. It's just the devil challenging you and trying to knock you off balance a little bit. Okay, so I just want to pass that word on to you this morning. So let's pray for those who were baptized and for any others who are considering it. And if there is anyone who hasn't yet been baptized as a believer by immersion and you want to be, please come and let me know. Father God, we thank you for the tremendous day we had last Sunday with the baptisms. And Lord, we want to continue to pray for Susan, for Joanne, for Anne, for Shirley and Mal and Andrew, for your blessing upon them, for your protection, Lord, when the devil comes and puts negative thoughts in their mind or difficult circumstances in their life. Help them to know, Father, this is a part of what often happens, and to just turn again afresh closer to you and to find the strength and help of your Holy Spirit. Bless those who are baptized. And Lord, may we see many more baptisms through our church in the weeks and months and years ahead. Hear our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Tonight we're going to be starting a new series of messages on the return of Jesus Christ from Revelation chapters 19 to 22. The return of the King. If you want to know what it's going to be like when the kingdom comes, come along and have a listen. We're going to stand in a moment and sing a great old hymn on this idea that God is speaking to us through the world around us. How great thou art. Okay, let's sing our last hymn before we close in prayer.
Thanks.
that God, His Son of Spirit, sent Him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, He bled and died to take away my sin.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.